Bonjour. So I have the worst thing to do that I can do, which is talk English. So, hello, thank you. I'm very proud and we are very happy to have today Peter at 42. We visited the school this morning. Peter is a kind of living legend. He has done a lot of things that you know. First one, you created PayPal, which is first thing. It should, for a lot of people, that should be the end of a total life. But it was only one thing for you. You also created Palantir, and Alex Karp came to visit us a few weeks ago. You were the first who invested in Facebook, and it was a big success, and it's a big success till tomorrow. And you are now a venture capital, a philanthropist, a philosopher. Can I say that?
Yeah, maybe. I'm not sure about that.
So it's what I think. And we are very proud to have you today. You have students from 42 and from another school called HEC, a very good economy school in France. And some of them are doing an internship kind of program, which is a nine weeks entrepreneurship program. So this is the people who are in the audience. And so thank you for coming. And thank you for coming, and I leave you the mic. And you have already.
Right, so I'm mic'd up.
I'm very impressed. Sorry.
Well, thank you. Well, thank you for having me. I thought I'd make maybe some brief comments and then make it as interactive as possible, as much Q&A, and have as much of a conversation with all of you as possible. One of the big challenges in teaching entrepreneurship and writing about entrepreneurship is that there's a sense in which every single moment in business happens only once. And so, the next Mark Zuckerberg will not be starting a social networking site. The next Bill Gates won't start an operating system. The next Larry Page will not be starting a search engine. And so if you simply copy these people, there's some sense in which you're not precisely learning from them. I used to always like talking about PayPal in years past, and I'd tell all these stories about what I did at PayPal. And they're interesting, and there may be some things to learn, but we combined email with money, and this was a very innovative idea in 1999 when we came up with it. You could not have done it in 1985 because almost nobody was using email. But it would not be that good an idea in 2016 because it was already done 17 years ago. And so this is, I think, always this deep paradox about trying to teach innovation or teach entrepreneurship, because in education you're always trying to copy things that already have been done, whereas innovation is about doing things that are new. And so the approach I always like to try to take is a somewhat indirect approach of asking a set of contrarian questions. And the sort of the intellectual question that I always think is a good one is, tell me something that's true that very few people agree with you on. This is sort of a way to stimulate thinking. And the business version of that question is, what great company is nobody starting? The nonprofit version of this is, what good causes is nobody investing in? Let's come back to the intellectual question. Tell me something that's true that very few people agree with you on. This is one of these interview questions that's a shockingly hard question, even when people can read on the internet that I ask this question of everybody who comes in the door. It's still a hard question to answer. And it's hard not just because most of the standard answers, it's hard to come up with something brilliant or new that people haven't thought of, but it's socially difficult because a good answer is one that the person asking the question won't agree with. And when you're when you're talking to somebody, you're always just trying to say the things they want to hear that they want to already agree with. And I think this is one of the things that always makes real innovation so difficult. It's not the creativity, but it's the courage that's needed to do things that are different. I think we live in a world in which courage is in much shorter supply than genius. Now, I want to maybe just to provoke some thinking, give you a few of my contrarian answers to this question, things that I believe to be true that very few people agree with me on, and then maybe use that as a starting point for a conversation. So one big thematic answer that I have, it comes out of this idea that you know, the good companies are always unique, they're one of a kind, they're doing something other people are not doing, is that I think we often say that business is all about competition, about competing very intensely, and I think it's actually about monopoly. And I think that that if you are the founder of a business, you always should aim for a monopoly. You want to be doing something that's so much better, so different from anybody else, that there's on some level no competition at all. And so we live in a world in which people are always focused on competing like crazy, and it has many benefits when you compete. You get to be better at that which you're competing on, but it often comes at this very high price of losing sight of things that are really valuable, really important. You know, if you want to compete like crazy, you should just open a restaurant. It's a terrible idea. You know, even in Paris, it's a bad idea, I think. It's a terrible idea in San Francisco, where I live. You have fantastic restaurants. It's good for society, but it's a terrible business because there's so many people doing the exact same thing. And then the paradigm I give of a, you know, extremely successful business is something like Google, where they have not had any real competition in search since 2002. And as a result, it's been extremely profitable, you know, for year after year after year. Now, I think this sort of the soundbite version of this is that most people think capitalism and competition are synonyms, that they mean the same thing. I think they're opposites, because a capitalist is someone who's in the business of accumulating capital. A world of intense competition is a world where all the profits are competed away, like in the restaurant business. Now, I think this idea is always very poorly understood, though. So my single business idea is you always want to go for monopoly, and yet this is shockingly poorly understood. And I think there are many reasons for this. You know, one of them is just that on the level of the businesses themselves, people don't talk about this. So if you're running Google, if you're the CEO of Google, you don't travel around saying, we have a monopoly that's much more profitable than the monopoly Microsoft ever had in the 1990s. We're making enormous profit margins. There's no competition in sight. If you do that, you'll get the attention of the government very quickly. And so what you say instead is, Google is in this business called technology. It is the most competitive industry imaginable, and we're competing with Apple on the iPhone, with Android, and we're competing with Facebook and Amazon, and there's just crazy, crazy competition everywhere. And no, this is not the monopoly the government's looking for. And so there's always this extraordinary distortion that happens. You know, conversely, by the way, the same sort of distortion happens when people are in very competitive things. They often understate it. So if you were to leave my talk today and say, you know, I don't agree with anything Peter said, I'm gonna just go open that restaurant like I had planned to. You know, if you try to open a restaurant, you quickly run into some problems where people say, well, it's a bad business, we're just gonna lose money if we give it to you. And then you come up with a fictional story and you say, well, this is going to be a very different restaurant. It'll be different from all other restaurants. It'll be the only British, Nepalese fusion cuisine in Paris. And so you can always tell a fictional story where you make it unique. And the people who have too much competition, they tell the fictional story by making the markets fictionally small. And the people who have monopolies tell a fictional story of competition by making the market fictionally big. So the restaurant business, there's too much competition, and you pretend it's just the relevant market is Nepalese British fusion cuisine, even though it's just a restaurant. You know, that's actually people go to eat something else. You're really competing with French restaurants and all sorts of other ones. And then on the IT side, if you're Google, you don't say that the market is search, you say the market is computers, and you tell a story about making it too big. So I think there are these incredible distortions that happen all the way through, where this monopoly question gets obscured over and over again. But I think there's also, but I think it's not just sort of this intellectual business reason why this question is understood so badly. I think there's also a little bit more of a psychological reason where we end up drawing so much of our identity from competing, from winning competitions in one way or another. And the autobiographical story I like to tell is that, you know, I grew up in Northern California, and it was sort of academically incredibly tracked. And, you know, I remember already in my eighth grade junior high school yearbook, you know, one of my friends wrote, you know, I know you're going to go to Stanford University in 4 years, one of the sort of U.S. elite universities. 4 years later, I got into Stanford. I went there as an undergraduate, then I went there to law school. You sort of win all these academic competitions, and when you win an academic competition, you get to go on to the next level and you compete again, and you sort of cycle and repeat. And then I ended up at a big law firm in Manhattan. And it was a very strange place where it was, from the outside, it was a place where everybody wanted to get in. On the inside, it was a place where everybody wanted to get out. When I left after 7 months and 3 days, one of the people down the hall from me said, you know, it's so reassuring to see you leave. I had no idea it was possible to escape from Alcatraz. You know, the big. That's the way people sort of mentally thought of the place they were in, and of course, all you had to do was, you know, go out the front door, and not come back. But psychologically, people couldn't do that because their identity, their sense of self, was wrapped up in these competitions they'd won against other people, and so it was almost inconceivable for people to end up leaving. And I think this is one of the things that's both, you know, if you compete like crazy, if you're like a swimmer in high school or a runner, you get very good at that which you're competing on, but you end up often losing sight of the bigger context. And in business, the bigger context is not necessarily how do you beat this other company, but it's often much more what should you be doing in the first place. You know, and so whenever you have businesses that are too focused on how we're going to beat somebody else, that's not necessarily what it's about. It's about not about destroying other people. It's about building a successful company. One of my friends in California built this company in the late 90s called Napster, which was this online music service. And their mission was to destroy the music industry. And you know, they were going to disrupt things, destroy everything. And they actually, I think they succeeded pretty broadly in destroying the music industry to an extraordinary degree. The company itself had a disruptive name, you know, Napster, you nap some music, you nap a child, you're a kidnapper. So it had sort of that sort of a connotation, of course. But that's not the goal in business. It's not to destroy other things. It's to build something that is successful. So this monopoly competition perspectives gives me a lot of different ways to evaluate things. And I'll just mention two others in passing. One of the ideas, one of the sort of business school ideas you're always told when you look at starting a new market is how big is the market? And you're told you want to go into markets that are very, very big. And I'm always nervous about big markets because big markets mean that there are a lot of other people in them and that there's a lot of competition. And what I think often is really good is to go after markets that are very small, because when you're a startup, if it's a small market, you can take over the whole market. And what's important is not so much the size of the market, but how you can get to a large share of the market quickly. And so when Facebook started, it started with 10,000 students at Harvard University, and you went from 0 to 60% market share in 10 days. So that was a very promising start. And then they sort of built it out in concentric circles. You know, PayPal, we started with power sellers on eBay. There were about 30,000 of them. And in about 3 months, we went from, you know, 0 to about 30-35%. So again, it was a very promising start. We have this relatively small market, and you can sort of take over the whole market. And then when you have these enormous markets, that's often been much more challenging. So one One sort of area that's been, you know, that I think is very important for us to be innovating in, but that's been quite hard for a lot of companies, has been the clean tech area. And in Silicon Valley, we had a little bit of a clean tech bubble in the years 2005 to 2008. A lot of money was invested in clean tech businesses. A few of them have succeeded, but most of them ran into trouble. And one of the systematic errors that I think happened was the market was too big. And so every PowerPoint presentation that you saw pitching a clean tech business in that period, it started with, we have this enormous market that's measured in hundreds of billions or trillions of dollars. And we're going to have a fraction of that market, and we'll still have a big business. But the challenge is that, okay, you're a thin film solar panel company, and then you have to beat 9 other thin film solar panel companies, and then you have to beat 90 other solar panel companies, and then there were the windmills, and then there was the fracking industry, and there was Chinese manufacturing. And if you're just a small fish in a giant ocean, that's always a bad place to be. And so I think, even though there are times when you need to compete, there are times when you need to beat people, it's always a very good thing to think hard in advance. Is this really the space you want to go? And if it's a space where there are too many people doing something, you may want to think twice about it in different ways. Now, one of the questions I always get asked in these contexts is, what are some trends for the future? Where do I see things going? I always dislike answering that question because, on some level, I'm not a prophet. I can't really foretell the future. I can tell you sort of very banal things. I can say that there will be, 5 years, there'll be more people using smartphones or things, but that doesn't really mean anything at all. But one thing that I've come to believe is that every trend that people talk about is exaggerated. In Silicon Valley, there's a trend around educational software or healthcare IT software, somewhat exaggerated. You have to be very careful about investing in that. SaaS enterprise software, very exaggerated. If you hear the words big data, cloud computing, you need to run away as fast as you can. You need to almost think that it's like fraud or something like that is going on. And the reason you should be careful about the buzzwords is that the buzzwords, they're a tell. They're like an indication, like in poker, that someone's bluffing and that there's nothing real. So if I had a pitch for a startup, an elevator pitch, where I just had a whole series of buzzwords. So we're building a mobile platform for SaaS businesses to bring big data to the cloud. That's what we're doing. This litany of buzzwords tells you, maybe you have something very unique, but my sort of pattern recognition is that, wow, it sounds like you're doing something that's similar to what many other people are doing, and therefore I'm sort of biased not even to look at it anymore because it's likely already to be too competitive. And so the trends, the buzzwords, these things are always somehow too crowded. And by contrast, the kinds of businesses that I think have worked have been ones where they were one of a kind, and often we do not even have the language to describe what the businesses are doing. I'm an investor in Airbnb, and people try to come up with this category. It's the sharing economy or something like that. But it's really just a very unique, one-of-a-kind business that sort of figured out ways to provide, inexpensive accommodations to tourists and other people as they travel around the world. It doesn't actually fit into any pre-existing categories. And most of the businesses that I found over the years to be very good are ones where they don't fit into categories, or we don't even have the language for them. Or if we fit them into categories, it's actually misleading. So for example, people would have said, oh, Google's a search engine or Facebook's a social network. These are categories you put them in. And I think in both of those cases, that was a really big mistake. Google, I would say, was, if it was just another search engine, that would not have been interesting. It was the first computer-powered search. There were all, and so it was the first machine-powered search. And that was the real category for Google, was it was computer-powered search without human beings sorting out the different lists as they had done with all the other search engines in the mid to late 90s. And then Facebook, you know, there were all sorts of social networking companies before Facebook. One of my good friends, Reid Hoffman, who started LinkedIn years earlier, had started a company in already 1997, 96, 97, and it was called SocialNet. So they already had social networking in the name of the company 7 years before Facebook. And they had, it was sort of the late 1990s, they had all these ideas about what it was supposed to be. It was going to be virtual networking on the internet, where some people, you would pretend to be a virtual dog and someone else would be a virtual cat. And we'd figure out ways for these fictional people to interact with one another on the internet. And it turns out it's not about social networking. People are not interested in having fake relationships with other people who pretend to be fake cats or fake dogs. And what actually mattered was not social networking, but real identity. What was so powerful, so unique, maybe controversial about Facebook was that it was the first company in some ways to crack real identity. That's the correct category in which to put Facebook. But because our bias is always to put things in pre-existing categories, Facebook was simply called a social networking site. Google was just called a search engine. And this sort of bias to categorize things led people to ignore what was actually unique and different, whereas where Google was, I would say, the first machine-powered search, and Google was the first company to crack real identity, which is what which was what ultimately made it so powerful. So so I think it's there's always this need to not go with the trends, but to try to find the sort of unique constellation that can work in different ways. let me end with one slightly bigger picture theme, and then maybe just open it up to some questions from the audience. I often in my class and book, I sort of try to contrast two different ways in which there's going to be progress in the 21st century. And I think I describe them as technology and globalization. I describe globalization, I always draw it on an x-axis. I describe it as copying things that work, doing more of the same. It's horizontal, extensive growth. And I always draw technology on a y-axis. It's doing something new, going from 0 to 1, vertical or intensive growth. And I think we often live in a world in which people use the words globalization and technology synonymously. But I think they're actually very, very different. And they're very different kinds of things. There's something about globalization that is in fact quite mechanistic. China is the paradigm example for globalization. All that China has had to do over the last 40 years is copy the West, copy Western Europe, copy the US, figure out what works. You can skip some steps. Now, there's some point where that breaks down, where once you've copied everything there's to copy, it sort of reaches a natural limit. But for many decades, that's been a very, very straightforward thing for China or other developing countries to do. And so globalization has this automatic, mechanistic feel to it. On the other hand, technology, I think, is very different, because for those of us living in the U.S., Western Europe, places like that, I think the future is going to be primarily about doing new things, about coming up with ways to innovate and to progress. And I think this is extremely important for our societies. It's how we build a better world, and it's and I think we need to somehow resist the very pervasive pessimism there is. I think this is again sort of a controversial thesis, but I think we live in societies that are orientated very powerfully against technology and against the future. You can look at this, if you just look at all the Hollywood science fiction movies, they all portray technology that doesn't work, that kills people, that destroys the planet. It's Avatar, it's Elysium, it's Terminator, it's robots killing people. There was there was the Gravity movie where they were in outer space, and you were happy to be back on a muddy tropical island somewhere. And so the image is always that technology is undesirable and bad. And yet I think that the alternative to a technological future is one in which we're deeply stuck. And it's sort of ingrained almost in the way that we talk about the world today. In the 1950s and 1960s, you would have talked about the first world and the third world. The first world was that part that was technologically advancing. There was no globalization to speak of. The third world was sort of permanently screwed up. So that was sort of a world where you had technology, but no globalization. And since the 1970s, we've had a lot of globalization. And so now we speak not of the first world and the third world, but we speak of the developed world and the developing world. And the developing countries are those countries that are copying the developed countries. And so this is a convergence theory of history. It's about globalization. So we're living in a world that's very pro-globalization. But it is also implicitly, against technology. And when we call France or the United States, when we say that this is a developed country, we are saying implicitly that it is a country where everything has been discovered in the past, where things are done, where it's finished, where the younger generation should have lower expectations than their parents. And I think this is a conception of our world that we should very powerfully resist. And so I think we should always, in all sorts of different ways, try to find a way to return to the contrarian question: how do we go about developing our so-called developed world? Thank you very much.
I think you have some questions.
Just so you let journalists understand, we're going to switch students and
journalists.
Yeah. So I got a first question. So here at 42, we keep hearing build an MVP, launch fast, get feedbacks, and iterate. Whereas you say in your book to literally forget MVPs and rather have a more definite plan of your business. So what's your point of view on this, and who should we trust then?
Well, there's definitely I would say there's no contradiction. So if MVP is a minimum viable product, and so if you have an MVP, then you can always iterate around that. I'm a little bit critical of sort of the lean startup. Not in theory. In theory, there's nothing wrong with it, but in practice, people often forget about the MVP part. So if you just iterate and you forget about whether or not you have a minimum viable product, I think that does not work. So the basic challenge, it's sort of like it's occasionally worked, but if you sort of have, we have four people, we're really talented, we have no idea what we're going to do. We're going to lock ourselves in a room, and we're going to come up with ideas. That's not a company I'd be comfortable investing in. And even though there have been a few instances where it feels almost by chance that the people stumbled on things. It's always much more, is there at least some core idea that people are really focused on, that really anchors things. Within that context, it's of course a fictitious thing to say that, everything was planned out methodically, from day one to end. PayPal. We had this idea about building a new payment system. We didn't know that it was going to take off on eBay. So that's something where, you know, we shifted the marketing and product focus onto optimizing it for eBay once we saw people were using it. Facebook had very big ambitions from day one, but sort of exactly how the stress was placed changed over time. But I think it's, you can think of both both as a search problem. You have this incredible space of possible companies you're searching through, and how do you find one that works? And you have to figure out some ways to narrow the search. And I tend to think, you know, one important initial anchoring is that there's some core idea that makes sense and around which you build an MVP. And then once you have that, you know, certainly you can iterate in different ways. So yeah, in theory, I think there's no conflict. In practice, I often find myself at odds with the people who talk about iteration but seem to forget the MVP part.
So you started the Thiel Scholarship or Fellowship to get people to drop out of university and college and start a business instead, because as you say on the website, it's not worth it learning in a classroom environment. Now, seeing that we don't exactly have a classroom here, would you still encourage students at 42 to drop out of 42 to join the Thiel Scholarship?
Well, let me say again, in general, I'm not into competition, and this I certainly would not want to compete with 42 on any level whatsoever. So let's just be very clear on that. My general view on education is that there is an existing system that is working sort of less and less well in different ways. the analogy I've come up with of the existing university system, both in France or in the United States, is that it is like the Catholic Church 500 years ago. They're selling people indulgences. They have a priestly class of professors. They charge more and more each year, and there's no salvation outside the church. In the same way, if you do not get a diploma from a university, you will go to hell, and otherwise you're saved. So we have this sort of monolithic system, and I think there's a need for some kind of a reformation of that system. The goal on neither my part nor from what my understanding would be about Davi's part here, the goal is not to create a new monolithic church to replace it. And so I think there is, I think in the future, there will be room for many different kinds of approaches to what can be done differently. And so my goal is not to get everybody to drop out of college. There are some people where I think it's the right thing to go to college, it's the right thing to get a degree, but it is to question this one size fits all. And it's this very odd way this debate gets set up, where you either have to have an answer where everybody has to do the same thing, or if you say, well, I don't think everybody should do that, then nobody should do that. And these are not, you know, those are, it's true that everybody and nobody are exclusive, but those aren't not exhaustive possibilities. And I think we have to, you know, you have to sort of move beyond this thing where, you know, Yale, you know, everybody goes, you go to Yale or you go to jail, sort of an expression in the United States. And yeah, it's good to go to Yale, it's bad to go to jail, but those should not be the only two options.
How do you explain that so many PayPal early staff members were successful in creating their own business after PayPal?
Yeah, it's always hard to, you know, PayPal ended up, there ended up being a lot of ex-PayPal people went on to start successful companies, LinkedIn, Tesla, SpaceX, Palantir, Yelp, YouTube. So the ex-PayPal people, there was quite a number of successful businesses. I think there's sort of a lot of, these things are always sort of a little bit overdetermined. It's hard to know exactly why. So I think the time, early 2000s was perhaps a good time to start these businesses. It was still a fairly young team. The PayPal period had been fairly short. So there were sort of a lot of different things that came together The one part of the lesson that I think that I like to stress is that if you're in a startup, it can either, things can work incredibly well and it can be easy, it can be impossibly hard and it fails, or it can be hard but successful at the end of the day. So you sort of think of these three routes for startups to go. And even though I think we all want to be in ones where it's easy and wildly successful, those are not necessarily the best from a pedagogical perspective. And so if you're in a startup that is easy and wildly successful, you will learn it's very easy to do this and you're very likely to fail. If you're in one that just fails, where everything goes wrong, you're likely to learn it's impossible. You will try something less ambitious. And so I actually think that the easy successes and the ones where things just totally go wrong are both very bad because they sort of teach people the wrong lessons. And parenthetically, this is one of the reasons I'm always a little bit skeptical of the sort of cult of failure that exists in Silicon Valley, where it's supposed to be a good thing to fail. And you know, it's certainly, if you fail, it's important to move on. But there isn't that much that you can learn from failure, because when you fail, there's so many different reasons you failed. The most important thing when you fail is just to move on. But in practice, very often, if you were in failed or wildly successful companies, you wouldn't necessarily learn the right lessons. PayPal was one where it was very hard. There was sort of a lot of different challenges. We had competitive challenges with eBay and Visa and MasterCard and the banks. There were regulatory challenges. There were product questions. There were fraud issues. There were questions, how do you get the customers? So you sort of were exposed to many different problems. And the lesson that people who went through that experience came out with, the high-level lesson was, you can build a great company, but it's very hard. Ex ante, if you could, in some ways the people who went to Google or Microsoft did better because the companies ended up being so much bigger. In some ways those were better companies, but I think pedagogically they were worse. And so if you look at how many successful companies have been started by ex-Google people or ex-Microsoft people, it's actually surprisingly few. And I think it is because somehow a lot of very bad lessons get learned in those places. And so at Google, it's the free sushi, it's the lava lamps, it's things like that. That's sort of, people sort of magically think that that's why it works. And when the real reasons it works, I think, tend to be very obscured. The monopoly thing, which is why I think Google really worked, is understood, I think, by like the five people at the top of the company, and the 30,000 others have no clue. And so when they then go on and start companies of their own, that's been much more challenging. And so I think there've been, even though Google, has maybe 150, PayPal had 200 people when it was acquired. 200 people working on the software product business side when it was acquired by eBay in 2002. It's 700 in customer service, but 200 on sort of the core product engineering side. Google has maybe 20,000 people in that category, so like 100 times as many. If you gave them the test, they're probably as talented or more talented than the people we had at PayPal. The track record, I think there have been fewer successful companies outside of coming out of all the people from Google than from the much smaller number of people coming out of Facebook, coming out of PayPal. And I think it's largely because of this, of somehow the context having taught really the wrong lessons.
Hello. What are the three books that most influenced you?
There's so many different, I'm always bad at answering that question. They're all sort of idiosyncratic. There's a whole list of books I've told people to read, but I don't think there's anything automatic about it. There was one, when I started PayPal, there was a Neal Stephenson novel called Cryptonomicon, which is about cyber currency. And I remember reading it at I was standing in line at Heathrow Airport in London, and someone behind me said, that's a really cool book. I was saying, yeah, I'm building the company described in this book. So you have like idiosyncratic things like this. That there was a book called The Sovereign Individual, which was around cryptocurrency. It was written in the 90s, which is, I'm not even sure it was that good a book, but it ended up being, you know, very inspiring to me in different ways. And so I think there are, you know, I think there are things like that, but it's again, I would say there's no one size fits all. I think a lot of learning, a lot of books, it often has a slightly autodidactic thing where there's some area that you're really passionate about, and then you end up exploring, and that's how you really come to understand it on a much deeper level than you otherwise would.
Any question from journalists?
Good morning. Could you please tell us how do you select the company you're investing in? Are you looking at the technology? Are you looking at the people?
So as an investor, I'm always hesitant to say that there's, again, very skeptical of formulas. You know, if there was a simple formula, that if I could just tell you the formula, then all you could infer would be that I'm not telling you the truth. But if I had to give a partial formula, which is not sufficient, but just a partial formula, would be it's three parts. It's people, technology, and business strategy. And so the people question is always, it's never just an individual question. It's always more of a team question. Companies are more than one person, they're always a team. And so the critical question is, how well will these presumably talented people work together? And so one of the questions I always like to ask is the prehistory question on the people side. You know, when did you meet? How long have you been working on this? A bad answer to the prehistory question is, we met a week ago at a business networking event in Paris, and we have nothing in common, but we both want to start a company. We both want to be entrepreneurs, or something like that. That's sort of a bad answer. A good answer is, we've been friends for 3 years at Ecole 42, and we've, you know, one of us is more on the business side, one's more on the technical side, and we've been working on this idea for a long time. So long prehistory is a good answer. But it's always, the people question is important, but it's always this team question that I try to drill down on. The technology is again something that you can never you want something that's significantly better than things that exist, and so it's again something you cannot evaluate in a vacuum. So it's, if you have people tell you, okay, this is our technology, and it always sounds great, it always sounds great, but the question is always this much bigger context. So what are other people doing? You have to have, you can only evaluate it by having some context of everything else that is going on. And then similarly with the business strategy of, you know, what is it that's unique that will enable it to be a one of a kind business? And somehow we've done very well when we've gotten all three lined up. When they're, you know, it's, you don't always want to insist on them, but if one of them is seriously missing, this can be a big challenge. But I think one of the very misleading things about evaluating startups is to think that it's like some sort of Shark Tank or some TV show where, you know, you just you have like a 5-minute elevator pitch or something like that. It's always companies don't exist on their own. They always exist within a bigger context, and you have to try to understand the entire ecosystem. And you can never have this reductionist thing where it's just about the elements that make up a given company. It's always this question of how it fits within the larger ecosystem, and that's something you can typically not answer in a 5-minute elevator pitch or something like that. You know, people often ask me, you know, how did Mark Zuckerberg pitch me on Facebook, or why did we make that investment in 2004? You know, he was 19 years old. He was kind of shy. He didn't talk very much. You know, the business had already they had already 100,000 users. It was taking off. The engineering team seemed to be pretty good, But the main thing was, you know, my friend Reed and I had been looking at all these social networking companies for about a year before that. And so, you know, we'd done a lot of homework, and so we were going to invest in Facebook almost no matter what Mark Zuckerberg said, or we were ready to do that almost no matter what. And so it's always this bigger context, and it's not like some sort of a elevator pitch, Shark Tank. I just need to say the right magic words, abracadabra, and you know, I'll sort of unlock the safe and get the money.
Hi, sorry for the trend profit type of question, but do you think there is a bubble in data science?
I think if the question, on that level of abstraction, I do feel there is something like that. It's always there's always a question. I'm always skeptical of abstraction. So I think one of the attributes of the various bubbles that we've had in all sorts of areas is that they involve a tremendous amount of abstraction. Where you know we have a bubble in technology in the late 90s. You know, yes, there was something around the specifics of the internet that were very important, but if you abstracted and said it doesn't matter what the companies are or what the specifics are, that was a catastrophic mistake. Or you know, I've said that we have a bubble in education, and where people are overvaluing certain forms of education in our society, and the specific mistake, one of the things that's very wrong with the education bubble today is that education is just such an abstraction, where it's education. It doesn't actually matter what specifically you're learning. I think one of the attributes of all these bubbles is that they involve way too much abstraction. And so data science is again, like, it is an extreme abstraction. It's like saying the internet or education. You can't be against the internet, you can't be against education, you can't be against data or science, data science. But it's way too abstract, and so I think the question I always ask is not about trends, but about the specific instantiation. Is this a company where this makes sense, or something like that? And what I've, again, this is much of a generalization, but in many cases, what I've found is you have companies that have, maybe there's some particular business strategy that's working quite well, then they're going to get all this data, and then there's a claim that the data will be mined and they will get sort of a lot more out of the data. And when you push on exactly how does it get mined, how valuable is the data really, that's often where the answers are quite weak. And what that tells me is that in all sorts of other contexts, the people pitching these companies are able to tell investors the data science will get us the answer. And they haven't really thought it through that carefully. So yeah, so in theory, I think there should be something there, but in practice, it feels like the sort of thing that's often used to gloss things over. I was on it was about 4 years ago, slightly different context, but it's related. I was on this venture capital panel. It was, I guess, yes, spring of 2011, 4 or 5 years ago, in Silicon Valley. There were five venture capitalists, and you had to answer this trend question about trends about the future. actually, it was spring of 2012, so it was about 4 years ago, and then everybody had to have two trends about things that would be happening in the next 5 years, the other panelists had to vote on it, and then the audience as a whole would vote on this. You know, one of the people said he had been an investor in Tesla, but he was saying there's going to be a trend towards more electric cars. You know, the other four panelists all said no. The audience was 91% no, 9% yes. This was in Silicon Valley. And so, I mean, my contrarian bias at that point was to think, you know, maybe you should just buy Tesla shares right now. And that would have been so the right thing to do. It was actually, even though he claimed it was a trend, you know, it was just clearly, it was just pitching Tesla. You know, it was not even, it was not even, it was, it was a, It was a company masquerading as a trend in that case. But then on the other end of the spectrum, one of the ones I gave was that there was going to be a trend in which biology and computer science would converge, and biology would become a data science, would become like computer science, and there was going to be this trend of convergence between the two. All four panelists said yes. The audience voted yes, 200-0. The audience was unanimous. Everybody agreed. And so my contrarian intuition was, wow, I'm not sure why I was wrong, but if everybody agrees with me, I'm very nervous. and maybe there's something around that where it's too abstract, it glosses over a lot of details. There should be some way to make biology more of a data science, more of an information science, of a computer science, but maybe there's a lot of complexity around exactly how that happens. And the fact that everybody in the audience automatically said yes means that we've probably, and it hasn't happened yet, so it's not like, it's still some claim about the future. The fact that everybody is saying yes, that's telling you that somehow people aren't reflecting enough on it, and there are a lot of details in it that have not been properly thought through. And so I left that evening concluding we shouldn't do any more genomics investments for a while.
Hi. I would like to jump to the part in the book where you mention that we are kind of trapped in an undefined future. And how do you see, and we need a cultural revolution to go towards a definite future. So how do you see that happen, and what is needed to do that revolution?
Well, there's sort of a lot of different ideas in it. The context in which I discuss this in my book is always this question about how much of startups or life or business is a matter of luck or chance versus not. And this is a very hard question to answer. And people can disagree about this in different ways. But I think my my bias is that we talk too much about luck. Too much when we say that the future, that it's all a matter of luck, it ends up meaning that we can't say anything about the future, and you can just sort of figure it out as you go along. And the the sort of the tracked version of this that one sees a lot in the U.S. and I think many other parts of the world is you get a resume, you get things on your resume. And then what are you going to do with that? Well, I will get a job. I may not like the job, but then I'll end up get another line on the resume, and then you sort of build something up there, and sort of this random walk into the future. And you can be optimistic or pessimistic about that, even though I think people are getting more pessimistic over time because there's something around that has not worked that well. And what I think I think the thing that's very ambiguous about this question of luck is that it can be, on the one hand, it can be the statement about the universe. It's just unknowable, and there's a certain amount of randomness or chance that's just part of the nature of the universe. But it can also be a statement about our laziness, where it's just, we don't know, and so we're not going to think about things. And so, for example, as a venture capitalist, one of the tremendous temptations you have is people tell you about a business, and you'll say, well, it might work, it might not work, I don't really know, so I'll invest a small amount of money. And it's just a lottery ticket anyway. And then you can just end up buying a lot of lottery tickets very quickly. If I set up a table outside in the street and just said, okay, I'm just taking applications for startups, and I'll just write checks. I have no idea what's going to work. It might work, it might not. I'm just going to write a small check to everybody. Maybe it's a matter of luck, but maybe that's just a story I've told myself to be lazy. And what I've found to be true over the last number of years as a venture capitalist, or even as an entrepreneur, is that when you tell yourself that it's a matter of luck, you're not making a statement about the universe, but you're really making a statement about your laziness. And you need to think a lot harder. And so if it's like, well, maybe this will work and maybe it won't, that's mostly not a true statement. That's mostly a statement you're not thinking about it. So do you think it's going to work? Why might it work? Why might it not work? I was talking to a business the other day, and they were going to say, well, you know, we're just going to spend a lot of money on advertising. I'm not sure it's going to work or not, but we should at least try it. So again, you know, I would think you should really be able to think through a lot more why that might work or why that might not. So I think there's always this exercise we should be going through to try to be somewhat more definitive about the future. Not making an absolute categorical statement, but again, as a social critique, we live in societies, Western Europe, US, where in general people say you can't know anything about the future at all, you can't say anything about it, and in that sort of world, if you try to do it, you will have a big advantage. And you know, when I look back on even on the PayPal history, there were some things we got very right. So we had this big picture focus on payments, building out a system. One place where I think we were relatively weak was what was the business strategy around it. And we thought, you know, if it gets big, we'll figure it out eventually. And we did, but I think there were things we could have thought about much more clearly, and there was this sort of avoidance of thinking about that led to some very costly detours and mistakes in the process of building the PayPal business.
First, I wanted to thank you for your speech. It was quite inspirational, and I think now I want to buy your book and read it.
Good.
Second, there are two things you said that I was kind of processing it. First, you said that technology is getting more globalized. And the second one was that in the early stage of startup, you should like look to get go for a monopoly, so to get market shares quite quickly. So to me, in that, I feel like you have to go to the world leading economy to do that, to get market share quickly in a globalized world. So what should we do for developed countries such as France? Like, should we stay or leave, or what's your point of view on that one?
Well, I'm not at all sure well, there are advantages and disadvantages in the United States. The US has a very large market, but that can actually be a challenge, where if the market's too big, it can make it more competitive in different ways. So I don't think there's some advantage. You know, Silicon Valley, you have some sense of where the frontiers are, you have some sense of what other people are doing, and whether what you're doing is in fact unique or not. So there are definitely all sorts of pluses and minuses, but I'm not sure I would say that the size of the United States per se is always an advantage or a disadvantage. China, again, is this enormous market. Again, from an outside observer perspective, it strikes me as extraordinarily hard to start a new business in China, because it's just too hard to get to the scale that you need to. And so I think there are many cases where smaller countries, smaller markets are maybe even better ways to go about doing things. I was an investor in Spotify, the music service. They started in Sweden, and it was a small market, and they could get deals with all the record labels and sort of test it out in Sweden, see that it worked. And once it worked in Sweden, they were then able to scale it outside of that to other countries. Spotify was a business you could have never started in the United States, because the record labels would never say, we'll give you all the rights to the US, it's too big. And so there was this chicken and egg problem that you could solve in a small country like Sweden that you could not solve in a big country like the United States. There's a SaaS business I'm involved in called Xero, which is an accounting software business. It started in New Zealand, and they basically convinced small, medium businesses to adopt this sort of cloud-based accounting software. And it was, there was, again, something about New Zealand where you had network effects, word of mouth. In a smaller country, you could get sort of critical mass and traction in a way that it would be much, much harder to do in a very big place like the United States. So I think the size of the markets, can cut both ways in things, and we shouldn't be dogmatic about this one way or the other. They're obvious. I think one of the things that's somewhat difficult to generalize on, but we do have, one of the ways the internet is divided, will probably remain divided, is by language in different ways. And so there is a English internet, there's a Chinese internet, there's a French internet, there's a Spanish internet, and there probably are any number of businesses that that make sense to be built in France for the French internet. Maybe there's certain kinds where you can translate and where it again becomes just a single global brand. There are many others where I think it is language specific. Certainly, e-commerce, there are many parts of e-commerce that have been very language specific. Media things, probably language specific. So there are, again, you have to think very critically, when is it specific to a language, when is it not? But I think these things can cut all sorts of different ways. Certainly, bigger picture point, I would say for the last decade, 15 years, Silicon Valley has been a very good place to be, and there's been sort of a tremendous amount of innovation that's come out of there. There was a talk I gave at Stanford University in early 2005, and there were four or five of us on this panel, and the panel was entitled, "Where Will We Find the Next Google?" And it was sort of a search problem, but sort of a startup search problem. So we're looking to invest in the next Google, or for employees, students to join the next Google. So where do you find it? And this is an incredibly valuable, important search problem. Very hard to answer the question, but I think there's a 50% chance that it's within 8 kilometers of this room. And maybe you could say the next one was Facebook, which was actually sort of 2 kilometers away. And that was easier said than done, but there was a way in which in 2005, I think things were extremely centered on Silicon Valley because of the network effects and all sorts of things like this. If I had to fast forward to 2016 today, I think it is going to be more distributed. And so if you asked me, where will we find the next Google, I don't think it would, I think it's less than a 50% chance that it would be within 8 kilometers or even 80 kilometers of Stanford. It's still maybe 20%, 25%, 30%, but it's likely to be much more distributed. And it's not like there's one other city you can go to or one other place. I think it could be in Paris, it could be in Berlin, it could be in London, Tel Aviv, it could be somewhere even outside of any of these major cities. But I think it's going to be much more distributed in the next decade.
Last questions?
Okay. Hi, Peter. I'm Emily. I'm a French. I'm here. I'm a French journalist. So you tell us to resist to pessimism. You question us about how are we going to develop our so-called developing world in order to build a better world. In last January, the 30 Under 30 published by Forbes pointed out the social entrepreneurship for the first time. French entrepreneurs were well represented. So my question is, do you think social entrepreneurship can become the standard for the future? And do you think entrepreneurs have now the responsibility to answer to this social calling thanks to technology?
Well, I'm slightly critical of social entrepreneurship, because I think that very often when people try to do a good by do well by doing good, they often end up doing they often end up doing neither. I think a lot of it turns on the definition of the word social. What does social actually mean? And social can mean one of two very different things. Social can mean, number one, good for society, which of course nobody is going to disagree with. So it can mean, number one, good for society, or number two, it can mean good as seen by society. And the second meaning of social has the problem that it then ends up getting you into things that are incredibly conventional. Because when social is just what's seen as good by society, then as soon as you do something social, you're doing something that many other people already think is good. You're already in a world of clones, of copycats, and things that are not working all that well. So for example, there was, in recent years, there was this incredible focus on micro-lending, of figuring out ways to create all these micro-lending startups, for loans to emerging market countries, and was sort of a form of, that was sort of a classic form of social entrepreneurship. It was so conventionally understood to be good. There were far too many people doing this, and I think in philanthropy, one of the biggest challenges in philanthropy is the people aren't focused on doing what's good. They're focused on looking like they're good, and when you're focused on status instead of substance, I think you end up getting lost very quickly. Now, this doesn't mean that the only purpose of a company is to make money, or anything like that. I always think that if the only thing a company's trying to do is make money, that's very uninspiring. You're not even going to get the best people, and sort of it doesn't even work as a business. And that's not what I'm saying at all. But the kinds of companies I really like are what I always contrast with social entrepreneurship are mission-oriented companies. And a mission-oriented company is a company that has a mission where if they're not working on it, nobody in the world will. And so, for example, my colleague from PayPal, Elon Musk, started SpaceX. And SpaceX's mission is to send human beings to Mars. And there are all sorts of reasons Elon will give you why that's good. So it's like, you know, there may be catastrophe on this world and we need to be an interplanetary species. There may be all sorts of things that go wrong. But most people don't say that SpaceX is a form of social entrepreneurship. They don't put it in that category. And it's because the idea of going to Mars, even though Elon thinks that's really good, and the people who work at SpaceX tend to think that's really good, that's not something that's conventionally celebrated on the conference circuit at Davos or something like that. And so I always focus on mission-oriented companies where if we're not solving this problem, it's not going to be solved anywhere in the world. That's very motivating. That's very important. Social entrepreneurship where everyone is clapping and applauding themselves on how great they are. If we don't do it, there are 100 other people who are doing the exact same thing as we are. That ends up not working all that well. So I draw a very sharp contrast between those two.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.